everybody. Thank you very much for joining us here on this very special evening. I'm very excited that this year, as we start some events before the IIT Madras Chennai chapter, we're starting with a big bang. Here we have amongst us three of the most talented alumni and alumni spouse, Nitya here, who are going to be giving us a very special evening. So thank you all. Before we get to introduce the artist and the program, I just wanted to just give you a little bit of brief about what IIT Madras Alumni Association does and what we want to achieve as being part of the Chennai chapter. I know some of you here are friends of the artist, friends, relatives, and but this is specifically to the alumnus. So this is the second, this year we just recently started a new set of committee members headed by Shubha again, IIT Madras Alumni Association. We are working together to see how we can connect better, engage, and create more value for the alumnus. And also we are also stepping into areas where we can create some impact in the social space. So I just wanted to quickly read out some of the initiatives we're doing. This is in the interest that any of you are interested in getting involved in these initiatives, you can reach out to me and I can connect you with the right people. Starts with, of course, increasing chapter engagements. All through the last couple of years, you must have seen that there's been an increased number of activities that have been happening not just in Chennai but across the globe, including the grand the 50th year celebrations that we had, the Diamond Jubilee. Second is enhanced mentoring and career services. This is headed by Dr. Ganeshan, and we're trying to see how the alumni community can further engage with the institute. How can the alumni and student engagement further get enhanced? Third is on thought leadership and digital initiatives. Here, this is headed by a very young alumnus, 2010-2011 batch, Abhijit. He is going to see how he can amplify some of the alumni stories as well as the impact that the alumni are creating. Fourth is Sangam, which is our flagship event. All of you must have heard about it. Fifth is Voice of Women Initiative. This is headed by Preeti Agalayam, who's from my batch. And this is, again, there's going to be a lot of focus on seeing how we can empower women engineers. I think there are a lot of women in tech, a lot of women in many different fields, but I think there's going to be a lot of focus on engineering and core engineering and how women can be further empowered and assisted. The last one is Innovation for Bharat. This is headed by Krishnan, who's this year the Vice President of IITMAA. This is a very unique initiative where we want to give back to the society. We are engaging with government and other organizations to see how IIT and alumnus of IIT can collaborate to create social impact for India and Bharat. So these are some of the initiatives, and we really want all of you to stay engaged and connected and join with us in all these initiatives and the programs that we conduct throughout the year. Any further ideas on what you want to do as Chennai chapter, you can feel free to reach out to me. My name is Shyamla, and if you're not already part of some of the Chennai WhatsApp groups, again, just meet me before you leave. I can have you added. There's also some real good excitement. Like, I was so very excited to see that there's so many of us who are really interested in music. We're also looking at seeing if we can do something in music more frequently. Any of you are interested in that, again, just ping me and we can make sure that happens as well. So thank you once again for being here. I'm going to now just hand it over to Malathi, who's been extremely helpful and kind and assisted me throughout this last few weeks in organizing this event. She will be introducing the artists.
Thank you, Shamla. The artist bio is so long. I don't think I'll do justice. I'll pick a few brief points to highlight their musical career. Sri Raghavan Manian in the center is an alumnus. After pursuing many years of tech and management career, today he's into music completely. His musical interests are so diverse: Carnatic, Hindustani, classical, jazz, blues, you name it, he plays any of those 10 musical instruments. Raghavan hails from a musical family. He is the prime student of Dr. M. Balamurli Krishna. He learned from him for over 10 years and accompanied his guru in several of his concerts. Sri Raghavan has has won several awards, too many to talk about here. Notable ones are Vocal Music Award by Music Academy, Krishna Gana Sabha, Bharat Kalachar, and so on. Next, I'll introduce Srimati Vidya Subramaniam. She's part of the alumni network, Chennai Chapter. Vidya is an experienced Carnatic music vocalist and a senior disciple of Padma Bhushan Sri Lalgudi Jayaraman. Vidya heads a successful and rapidly growing online Carnatic music learning portal, an academy actually. Srimati Vidya and her team of teachers train students from all over the world. Her academic training in CA and MBA has been used well to adapt the spread of Carnatic music. She has been conferred the Kalai Mamani Award from the Tamil Nadu government in 2018. Srimati Vidya is a regular seasoned Kutcheri performer at all the leading Chennai Sabhas and Music Academy, and many of them, such as Krishna Gana Sabha, have honored her with awards. One line I will say about Vidya's music: it's pure, strict adherence to her guru Lalgudi's bani. Next, I will introduce Raja Raman Sundarajan. He is the grand nephew of Sangeeta Kalanidhi, Kala Acharya Sri B.V. Raman Lakshmanan, direct disciples of Sri Tiger Varadachari. His first Kacheri was at the All India Radio Chennai at the age of 12. He did his Sangeeta Arangetram subsequently at the Nungambakkam Cultural Academy in 92. Since then, he has been playing, performing, and accompanying his gurus B.V. Raman and B.V. Lakshmanan. As an alumnus of IIT Madras and IIM, he has carefully balanced his professional career and musical. In 2009, he got back into the Kacheri circuit by giving a concert at Brahma Gana Sabha. And now I'll introduce you the two accompanists for the evening. Srimati Sudha R.S. Iyer. She is the younger daughter of yesteryear's Carnatic vocalist Geeta of Uma Geeta sisters fame. She started her musical career as a vocalist and then also as a violinist. Later, her mother wanted her to also sing, so she now sings as a duo with her sister. They are Sudha and Sri Vidya together. They are vocalists. Srimati Sudha's musical guru include Kolkata Krishnamurti, and for violin, Lalita Raghavan. Srimati Sudha is an A-grade violinist from AIR Chennai. Her academic qualifications include music and Sanskritam, along with an MPhil and a PhD program that are all complementary to the music that she is pursuing. She has a full page of awards. I'll only talk about her M.S. Subbalakshmi National Award by Krishna Gana Sabha, Best Violinist in the Spirit of Youth Concerts by Music Academy. And Srimati Sudha, along with her sister, are regular in Chennai Kacheri scene. On the percussion, we have Sri T.R. Arvind Kaushik. Arvind hails from a family of musicians as well, initiated into the world of Carnatic at the age of 4. Arvind has trained in Mridangam, Ghatam, Chenda, Kanjira, Edakka, and Arumukham. Sri Arvind's gurus include Kalai Mamani Sri S. Gopakumar, who is a direct disciple of Sri T.K. Murthy. Presently, he is undergoing advanced training with Sri Managudi Ishwaran. His educational qualifications are complementary. He holds a master's and an MPhil in music and Mridangam. Sri Arvind has several awards to his credits. Important ones are Spirit of Youth Festival from Music Academy and Yuva Kala Bharati from Pondicherry. Welcome to the concert. Enjoy.
We wanted to take this opportunity to give you all a bird's eye view of what a Carnatic concert is all about. There are any number of topics that we can delve into, however deep, knee deep, neck deep as it gets. But we thought among all of those, one that is most immediate, most topical is the idea of the concert itself, the experience of attending a concert, especially with the concert season, the so-called Chennai season, just around the corner, what to expect. So we will be presenting a summary concert of sorts. But within that idea of a concert, we have given each other a lot of leeway to both collaborate on the same song, on the same ragam, as well as take time off and look at individually ragas in our respective banis. So maybe at the top of the discussion, we should talk a little bit about the concept of bani. Raj.
Yeah, before that, I just want to add, good one, right? I think this is not going to be a standard concert, really. I think it's while we spend some time practicing and rehearsing, I think it's for the most part, it's going to be unstructured in the sense that it's going to be free flowing both ways. We want questions to come from the audience. We would like to sort of have a very interactive sort of session. And I think we'll probably also do a couple of quiz questions. We got some goodies which we can give out to people who can, a lot of kids here who can identify ragams and stuff. So we thought we'll just make it a bit interesting for everyone. That's the way we really structured it.
To add to what Raghavan and Rajaraman said, let's keep it interactive. So if you have any questions, you're more than welcome to ask. And since we have a good number of kids here today, we do want to invite them to ask questions. So please don't think that your question is too rudimentary or anything like that. You know, if you may be a total newbie or a seasoned Rasika, if we know the answer, we are more than happy to share. And let's keep it a friendly discussion. And also to continue with what Raghavan said, see, we come from different schools of music. And it was just a week ago that we tried to have a jamming session to see how to practice and perform together. So this is not going to be like, say, Sudha and her sister performing, because they would have learned from the same guru for 20 years. So the style would be the same. It's going to be different styles. So we are going to try to do some things together, some things, you know, on our own. And we are also going to try to give you a bird's eye view of the different elements of a kacheri. That's part of the idea. And we will intersperse some explanations and some talking to hopefully add value to the whole listening experience. And we'll start off with a varnam. Typically, that's the opening piece in most Carnatic concerts. And it is usually performed in multiple speeds. And it's a great way to warm up the musicians' voices at the outset.
I just want to add that, you know, we are now going to be singing in C sharp, which is largely a shruti for you know, a male. So Vidya has been gracious enough to sing in the equivalent madhyamam, which is G sharp. It's not her scale really, so I just wanted to point that out right at the start. So.
And the varnam we are going to sing is one of the very traditional standard varnams that most students of Carnatic music learn. It is called the Navaraga Malika Varnam. So it is a varnam with 9 ragas in it, and the composer is Sri Patnam Subramaniyayar, who belongs to the hallowed lineage of Saint Tyagaraja. So he was one of the great musicians who came in Saint Tyagaraja's Shishya Parampara. And this varnam has a very interesting mix of 9 ragas, because certain raga malikas have very different ragas which are totally unrelated. The ragas in this varnam are actually somewhat fairly close, and that makes it quite an interesting composition.
Varnam means color, so you will see like a panchavarna kili, this is a navavarna varnam. navaraga malika.
Yeah.
Concert is an invocation to Lord Ganesha or sometimes Goddess Saraswati. So we present an evergreen classic today that I'm sure all of you have heard at some point.
And before that, should we ask a question about one of the ragams in the... Yeah. So there were 9 ragas, right? Instead of asking you which was the 7th raga, I would just go easy and ask you for any one of the ragas. This is for the younger ones here. Any one raga to begin with. So this is easy pickings. It will get harder.
Shri.
Shri.
Bye.
Thank you.
Hamsadhwani always succeeds in giving a bright start to a performance. And so it goes hand in hand with a lot of Ganesha songs. This one specifically, I guess the quiz question here is, which kshetra, which place in India does this song refer to? This is the question.
Vatapi.
Okay. Good for a bonus point. Which other place does it refer to? Does it refer to it?
The Mooladhara Kshetram. I have read that it refers usually to Thiruvarur.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but that's not a fair question. So Vatapi is.
Okay, so maybe we'll have easier level question, like who's the composer?
Oh, that's right. Who's the composer?
Because this is contentious. The Kshetram thing. Some people say Tiruvarur, some people talk about Vatapi and other.
That's a beautiful things. Story of how it was Vatapi and then it was Tiruvarur. And how the Ganesha actually moved from A to B. And
I see.
So on.
Oh, so the mudra goes as Guru Guha, in case you're thinking. Yeah, correct.
So, Tikshitar, as we know, belongs to the hallowed trinity of Carnatic music. The other two being Saint Tyagaraja and Sri Shama Shastri. And the three are considered as the greatest Carnatic composers for so many reasons. One is the value of the musical form and compositions that they have given to us, which really form the backbone of our Carnatic music system as it is today. So in this composition, you can really see a lot about Dikshitar's mastery. One is the, in addition to the beautiful, elaborate use of this ragam, Hamsadvani, it's an Audava ragam, 5-note scale. Sa re ga pa ni sa, probably one of the earlier full-blown kritis in this ragam, which really explores the ragam in depth. He was a master of Sanskrit language also. So I just wanted to give you an example, because composition is not just, just giving some adjectives to describe the god. These compositions are much more involved, and there are many layers of meaning, even beyond the superficial meaning that one can discern from the lyric. For example, the word bhuta, I came across the word being used multiple times in this composition. And in each usage, the word is given different meanings. For example, in the Anupallavi, Bhutadi samsevita charanam. So Bhuta here refers to the Bhuta Ganas, who are believed to be devotees of Shiva, who worship Ganesha, being the son of Shiva. In the second usage, I could find Bhuta Bhautika Prapancha Bharanam. So here he's talking about the Pancha Bhutas, the five elements of the universe. So Bhuta Bhautika, so that refers to the five elements. And then again in the Charanam, he says Bhutakaram, which is basically a gigantic form. So you can see that he was a master of not just the music, but also of the language, and he almost used it like a poetry.
I'm just reminded of one of the Navavarnams of Sri Dikshitar again on Kamalamba, and the same word Kamala is used as multiples, like she talked about. I think it's a Kalyani.
Kalyani.
And where the, every line, the word Kamala has a different meaning. So that's the genius of Muthuswami Dikshitar. The other thing I want to point out here is I think this raga itself is attributed to
his father,
right? It was Hamsadvani has been discovered, or
his creation,
yeah. And then obviously Hindustani has adapted it now.
And one interesting, or actually a proof that Hindustani music adopted Hamsadvani, and the significance of Vatapi Ganapatim as the foremost song in Hamsadvani is the fact that almost every bandish in Hindustani music sounds like Vatapi Ganapatim. So almost any composition in Hamsadvani in the north is an adaptation of Vatapi Ganapatim, to the point that one of my Hindustani musician friends said, this song does not have a chaya of Hamsadvani because it did not start like that. That was all the reason he needed to say this was not a very good representation. So that is not how we look at Hamsadvani, but no doubt it's the foremost composition in the raga. Right. So, the next song that we presented, because we spoke of the Carnatic trinity as being Tyagaraja's, Dikshitar and Shama Shastri, there are other trinities as well, but the composer of this song, the next one that we are taking up, is the son of trinity, one of them. He actually has the double distinction of having learnt from two of the trinities, Tyagaraja Swami as his guru and Shama Shastri as his own father. So this composer is doubly blessed, very special, and his compositions, though few in number, each one of them is a gem that represents the raga that he has composed. We present one such gem
And the quiz question will follow because this is a raga which has been adapted and used multiple times in cinema music, and probably it's a nice quiz question. So good for you to listen carefully, I guess.
Mo di ma ne si je ma ga ga ma ga ma ni ni ga ma ni sa ga ga ma ga ri ga ga ni ni sa ni ni sa ni da ma
ma ga ri sa sa ni pa ni pa ni ni sa ni ni sa sa ga ri sa ni sa ga ma ma ga ga ri sa ni sa ga ri ni sa ga ri ni sa ri sa sa ni pa ri ni sa sa ga ga ma ga ga ri sa ga ga ma ga ga ma ni ni sa ni sa ni sa ga ga ma ga ma ni ni da ma ni ni sa ga ga ma ga ri ga ga ri ni sa ni ni sa ni da ma ma ga ri sa sa ni
guesses on the ragam.
Preeti Gappola.
Oh, wow.
So, any song that...
You can tell the name?
Yeah.
Sing it.
Oh.
Sing it. Just go ahead and sing it. For a non-musician. Chinna kanna nadikira.
One interesting thing about ragas, see, we have many ways of classifying ragas. Often musicologists and academicians approach it in a very serious way. But the way I look at it when I teach students, because I have students of all kinds learning, if it's a raga that people can relate to instantly, like Riti Gavlai, right? That's one category. Like if you hear Riti Gavlai, whether it's in film music or a pure classical song like this one, it's a musical strain that will linger in your mind very easily. Like she sang that, na, 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 na. You start recognizing that basic tune, right? Then you start recognizing or identifying the raga Riti Gavlai. Of course, there are many layers of nuances to this ragam. It can be performed very elaborately. But the basic crux of the ragam can be captured very quickly. A few other examples, for example. Na, na, ra, na, na, na. Sahana, yeah. So please give Vidya a chocolate. So that's another ragam where, you know, if you hear a few songs in Sahana, you start recognizing. You know, these are a category which are usually loosely labeled as Rakti ragas, very high in emotive appeal. People relate to them. They feel musically very either, you know, emotional in some way, you know, happy or sad or filled with. Sahana is often associated, for example, with Karuna Rasam or compassion. So these are very old melodies which probably pre-existed any kind of classification by musicologists. So very steeped in history. And another thing I wanted to mention is, see, Riti Gavlai is a ragam where the Trinity have composed extensively. So to actually come after their time and compose a song which has probably overtaken other Trinity compositions in popularity is no mean feat. So that really shows the class of Subraya Shastri as a composer, because, you know, it's very difficult to compose in a ragam where the Trinity have composed, because they have explored almost all possible facets. So he's really come up with something unique. And I think Raghavan mentioned earlier, he only has composed a handful of songs, but each of them is a gem. So I just
want to add this on raga identification. That's obviously a topic for another day, but I don't know how many of you use apps like Shazam and SoundHound. If you have those on your phone, they're pretty handy because they help you identify songs which have been there, and which is the last database. And I was just reading up, I was watching a video in fact, which talks about how the software works. So apparently it does not, it picks up one part of the song and then maps it to its database, and which is interesting because what it actually tells you is the brain's actually doing that. The brain's picking up a Riti Gavlai and storing it somewhere. And then when you hear it somewhere else, it goes back and checks and says that, yeah, that's a pattern I remember, which is very interesting. You know, because when you have software that's trying to mimic how humans behave, it gets even interesting. In fact, a junior of ours, Sri Kumar, I mean, I was discussing this with him. I said, why can't we have an app?
A junior of yours, not mine.
So, yeah, he's your batch.
It's my batch.
And why can't you design an app where, you know, someone's singing Riti Gavlai and then you switch it on and then it tells you Riti Gavlai. So, I mean, that's one thing that you probably need to work on. But I think that speaks about how deep Carnatic music is, because there's so many facets to sort of explore that it becomes tough to have a watertight definition of Riti Gavlai itself, other than what she talked about.
So it goes back to etymology. Raga means emotion. Raga is an affectation of the mind. So in an essence, it captures a certain emotion or a certain set. It's a subset of emotions. So this is why ragas are elevated in Indian, both iconography and literature and of course music theory to the status of deities. So there is a ragini and there is a raga, male and female representations of, you know, I mean, it is not to mystify or deify, but simply the fact that there is complexity involved. And we really don't fully understand why a certain raga creates a certain impact on us. And we are not even sure if it creates the same impact on you as it does to me. But we are sure that it does leave an indelible sort of impact on you. And that's why they are called raga. they are literally colorations of the mind.
Just to add, I think so every raga, your interpretations can vary depending on what song you're singing. In the same Riti Gada could sound different in every concert, because you're not trying to repeat stuff, you're just trying to explore multiple things of the raga, and then every time you sing it, you go back and hear it, you think that, you know, you could have done something else. And there's so many great artists that have sung, each of their interpretations of the same raga. It's end of the day, it's the same arona, avrona, same notes. But the way they have interpreted the same Riti Gada becomes so different, it becomes interesting. And that's really how Carnatic music evolves as an art.
One other point I would like to add and highlight is that ragas are much more than scales. You know, for those who have significant exposure to Western music, this could be an interesting point to ponder over. Because a raga is actually like a form. You know, it's like, for example, just to contrast between Hamsadhwani and Riti Gaule, two of the ragas we performed. Hamsadhwani is a raga which steadfastly sticks to the arohanam avarohanam. I can't do too much in terms of, you know, trying to add any other note or anything like that. Then it would no longer be Hamsadhwani. Whereas Riti Gaule is not a scale-bound raga. Like, for example, this may be the arohanam you find in a book. But you would also hear people sing, that is perfectly acceptable. It is not a raga which is confined to...
There is Gamapa which is not there in the arohanam.
Yes, yes.
That's not there.
Correct. So it's not a raga you can look at a book and sing, you know. So that makes our musical system very complex for somebody whose ears are not attuned to it. That's why the oral exposure is so integral to learning and appreciating this
and
art
the good
form.
News is we are in the best part of the world. We have the music season just 3 weeks away.
We may ask a question.
Yes.
Yes.
The song that she sang, right? It was sung by Guru of one of the performances.
Oh, this
person.
Who's the
Sishya
and who's the Guru? Repeat the question a little louder so that.
Song Chinnakanna Nadikkiran was sung originally by a musician who's. Yeah. And who's the Sishya?
Yeah. Thanks.
Nice. Yeah, so he's going to sing.
Kangal solgindra kavidai ilavayadil yetane kodi. Kangal solgindra kavidai ilavayadil yetane kodi. Endrum kaadale kondaadum kaaviyame alage ilamai radame. இந்த மாயனின் லீலையில் மயங்குது உலகு சின்ன கண்ணன் அழைக்கிறான் ராதையே பூங்கோதையே அவள் மனம் கொண்ட ரகசிய ராகத்தில் பாடி சின்ன கண்ணன் அழைக்கிறான் சின்ன கண்ணன்
If you would like to take a 5-minute break now, we can do that. Yeah? Or continue?
Okay.
Maybe after a song or two, this is okay. We can take
just
it as
just to
it
give
comes.
You a heads up on what's coming up. So we are each planning to do a short solo, maybe each for about 10 to 15 minutes. And then we want to do an RTP. Again, everything is going to be fairly brief. But just to give you an idea of the different aspects of a Carnatic Kacheri performance. So maybe, you know, after half an hour or so, if you guys need a break, please feel free to let us know. Coming to what I'm going to present, it's in a very traditional ragam, Kamboji. This is a composition of Saint Tyagaraja. My guru Lal Gudi sir used to say that he's probably never performed a kacheri without at least one Tyagaraja Kriti. He belonged to the musical lineage of Saint Tyagaraja. And there's a little bit of history behind this composition. Lal Gudi sir's great-grandfather, Lal Gudi Ramayya, was Saint Tyagaraja's direct disciple. And when Tyagaraja visited their town of Lal Gudi, whose historical name is Tapas Tirthapuram, Sri Ramayya requested Saint Tyagaraja to compose on the deities, that is Shiva and Parvati, in Lal Gudi. The Shiva is known as Saptarishishwarar and the Parvati is known as Pravriddha Srimati. So this song belongs to a set known as the Lal Gudi Pancharatnam today. So when we talk about Tyagaraja's Pancharatnam, all of us are very familiar with the ones that are sung in Trivayar, the five famous Ghanaraga Pancharatnams. But he has also composed other Pancharatnams which are not as dramatic. They are more in the traditional Kriti format. So not so often sung in large groups like the Trivayar ones. But they are nevertheless gems that we should treasure and preserve. So this is one pretty rare Tyagaraja Kriti from the Lal Gudi Pancharatnam in the well-known raga Kamboji.
I want to add a very short mention. My guru used to say, when he would teach Pancharatnam, he'll teach one of them or all of them, and then he'll say, these are called Pancharatnams, but that's a misnomer. Every one of Tyagaraja's Kirtanas is a Ratnam. Just as she mentioned, the groupings are convenient, but the fact is that each one of them, the smaller ones even, have something special about them. That's why I think the proof of the pudding, we still venerate, of all the composers in existence, we venerate him the most. So.
Ah, 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 ah.
Thank you. Sari
Quiz questions. What thala was this? Yes. Anyone else wants to try? Yeah, you in the blue. Yeah, Tisra Jati Triputa. Actually, Adi Thalam is also a version of Triputa Thalam. Okay, so you're not entirely wrong. But Tisra Triputa, this is a relatively rare thala to find a Kriti in. And what language was this composition in? Yes.
Tamil?
It's not Telugu, actually it's a Sanskrit. Yeah. Yeah, so Tyagaraja we normally associate with Rama and Telugu. So this song defies both. It's a Devi Kriti in Sanskrit. And I just wanted to highlight, you know, we always talk about Dikshitar being a master of Sanskrit. So was Tyagaraja in his own inimitable manner. If you take the Charanam, he says, Raja Shekaratma Bhu Viraja Raja Sannute. So this is an indirect way of saying the goddess who is worshipped by Shiva, Brahma and Vishnu. So he could have easily said, you know, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, Sannute. You know, that's one way, like if you or me composed, we would probably compose at that level. See, Raja Shekhara is the Shiva who carries the moon on his forehead. Atma Bhu, the self-born, which is Brahma, because Brahma is the creator. He didn't have a father, he was self-born. Viraja Raja, so V is a reference to bird. Viraja, the king of birds, and the Garuda. So Garuda is mounted on by Vishnu. So Vishnu is the lord of Garuda. So he, so Sannute. So this goddess is worshipped by all three of them. So this again shows that the Trinity are like a class apart from anyone else who's ever been there so far. You know, the master, we just take Tyagaraja as someone who sang about Rama in a very emotive way in Telugu, but you can see a direct, you know, exception to the normal way we think of Tyagaraja.
One thing I want to add here, which is not entirely relevant to what she spoke about, but the way V comes, so there's a song in, it's a different song and different raga entirely, Sri Venkata Girisham in Suruti. But the second line, if you notice, is actually Vinayaka Turagarudam, but it is sung as Vinayaka, but Vinayaka is an entirely different meaning, right? It's a different god. So just to add, when she says V is actually, it means bird. So Vinayaka is again Garuda. And Vinayaka Turagarudam is Sri Venkatesh. So some of these things, I think it's good to understand the way the Sahityas are thinking as opposed to singing Vinayaka Turagarudam.
So before the break, we thought we would do a medley.
Yeah. So we probably need the screen and the projector also. So.
I have a question.
Yes, yes, please.
As a newbie, so please forgive if it is a basic question. You're talking about the format of the Kutcheri, right? So what influences the format? Is it, you know, the trinities, and do they set a format, or is it scientific, like Raghav said, Varnam it starts with so that the voice can be warmed, or does it go from simple to complex? And do people actually, in a way, is that the norm?
It's a great question. I think one thing about...
That you should ask T.M. Krishna.
So one thing that happens a lot is the is change in all kinds of music, and that is applicable in Carnatic music too. So yeah, the winds of change keep blowing, and concert formats keep changing, right? So it is dictated by attention spans, economics, social media, and so on and so forth.
Absolutely.
So you cannot deny the presence of
this sounds like a simple question, right? But it's absolutely not, because it's what you hear today is really an evolution over so many years.
And it continues to evolve.
Right. The format that we have come to accept in the last 60 or so years was one that Aryakudi Ramananda Iyengar actually established as the way to present for the audiences of that age, who were already getting used to the amplification of a microphone and the paucity of time, which translates to about 3 hours of leisure for a concert. So he planned a structure by which you can actually explore a lot about of the compositions of the ragas and so on. So within that frame period, one of the things that Ramananda Iyengar himself was very famous for was his concerts were supposed to be so tight. There was never a dull moment. So when you see an alapana slows you down, and the song picks up the pace, the kalpanaswara doubles the pace, and then it takes you to a climax. So there is a chance at any point in the concert, or even in one song of the concert, where you may lose focus. But the way that Ramananda Iyengar structured his presentation, and of course he was also a brilliant singer, was that at no point in time does your mind wander from the music, because this music itself is a beautiful path, the way he structured that. So this is probably why it has taken, it is still very much the standard way of singing.
I've associated with some of these musicians, I think the way some of the concerts are constructed, right, is also to do with how you sequence songs and tala. So you can't sing like five adi talas in a row. I mean, he would get up and go away, because I think he needs some action on a five beat thing or a seven beat. Or it gets really boring, right? So sometimes you plan, you need to look at everyone on stage, you need to think about the wildness, because everything is shuddha madhyamam, it gets boring. So you need to bring that variety, because there's so much to do within the overall construct, and that really is something that you learn with experience. But to just add to what Rag said, I think Sri Aryakudi, the way you look at some of his, you hear some of his concerts, I think it's unbelievable, because you would have done some five gana ragas, and you would have done, I don't know, he does all that, and he plans how long he's going to sing Panturali, and then he does a Todi, and then there's a Bhairavi, and there's a Kalyani RTP in the same concert. So that some of those things are unimaginable, and it's amazing control on how much you need to deliver. I guess that comes with a lot of experience and practice. But yeah, the question is something that's
very profound.
Very profound.
And to add to what they both already said, two things to remember is that this art form is very technical, and like with any music, it's totally abstract. So if you're going to a dance performance, even if you don't understand, you see something colorful happening on stage. So that can keep you riveted, even if you don't understand. Whereas with Carnatic music, it's very easy for the audience to zone out or get bored. So if you notice the concert structuring by the most successful artists, especially the yesteryear artists, you'll find that they gave a lot of importance to holding the attention of the audience. I've heard my guru Lalgudi Jayaraman sir speak many times about, you know, he would be very, very conscious if the audience is looking little shifty, and then they would have a plan B. You know, they would have planned something if there's a crowd, because the composition of the audience changes from venue to venue. You know, some maybe people, you know, the largely people who have been listening for 25 years, who are looking for very challenging stuff technically. Others may be totally new. And if you're going to do all rare stuff, rare ragas, rare talas, nobody knows what is happening, then they're going to get bored and, you know, zone out. So I think the best musicians are not only the most talented, but also the smartest in terms of kind of understanding if people are not seeming to follow what you're doing, then it's important to change, you know, to be open to change and change what you had planned at home to something that's a little
sometimes
more.
Sometimes even the season, sorry. So even the season, I think there is a season where everyone is singing Kalyani. I mean, you go to any sabha, there are seasons where I've heard there's a Kharada Priya happening in every, there's a Kodi season, right? So some of these, I think artists also try to, you know, do one up over the other. And what also happens is, I think structurally, I think what most artists do is, I think the main raga, the main piece where the Taniyavadaram is supposed to play, that mostly gets fixed first. And depending on what you choose, there's a sub-main, which is like either a Pratimadhyamam or a Shuddhamadhyam, depending on what you pick. And then the interludes and all the other things, right? That's largely how a format is done today, because you need to bear in mind how much time you've got to. You can't sing Yadukula Kambhoji for 3 hours, right? So you have to figure out something in 90 minutes and plan the entire concert that way. And then you have interludes, and most of the interludes are in this tala called Deshadi. So what we did was we, and what also happens is, I think, like Vidya probably mentioned, I think to keep the mood of the audience, you know, really lively, I think some of these are used as interludes, which sometimes, in my view, takes away the beauty of the sahitya, because if you actually try to understand what Tyagaraja Swami is trying to say in the song, and sometimes the way it's delivered, I think it's like pulls apart, but I think that's a discussion for another day. So what we're going to do is, we've picked up, we're going to be hitting 2020 in about a month's time. So we thought we'll do 20 songs back to back in Deshadi.
I think Rajesh had.
Yeah, exactly. So good. So we're only doing the Pallavi, we can't do the entire song.
The use of the word Desha in Deshadi is interesting. Desha actually means Videsha, it means from another place. Usually those ragas and those systems that come as imports come with that Desi Todi, Desi this, Desi that. It usually means it's from Hindustani music or from some other state. Whenever we send, whenever we from the in the south borrow from them, we call it Desh this, and they do the same thing too. A lot of the ragas that get borrowed from the south are known as Desi ragas. So the Desi or Desha format of Adi is this Adi, which has a very peculiar edupu, which means it is offset by a certain number of beats. Because a lot of Hindustani bandishes, especially the Chota Khayals, tend to have that sort of an offset before they hit the sum. Okay, that's a takita. That in, and there are lots of reasons for that. And this form, this talam, exploits that one nice little inbuilt climax within six, you know, within an offset, to pace up songs. So a lot of the Deshadi songs have this nice pace to it, which tends to immediately grab attention.
So what we also did is we put this into a PowerPoint. We used to sing slides, so we just thought, let's talk about the raga name and the composer so that you get an idea of what we're really trying to do out here.
Yeah. I am. Whoa.
rajasutta tanaya sadaya giri rajasutta tanaya sadaya giri rajasutta tanaya sadaya giri rajasutta tanaya sadaya giri rajasutta tanaya sadaya
Sarasa madana beda dalda chatura
sarasa samadana vedadalna chatura sarasa samadana vedadalna chatura sarasa samadana vedadalna chatura sarasa samadana vedadalna chatura sakile kadhi
Raghupade
ससुदाम्बुनि चलोद श्री राम राघव रघुवंश ससुदाम्बुनि चलोद श्री राम राघव राजेश्वर रघुवंश ससुदाम्बुनि चलोद श्री राम राघव राजेश्वर रघुवंश ससुदाम्बुनि चलोद श्री
మమ్ములు తెలుసుకో మనసులు మమ్ములు తెలుసుకో మన రక్షక మరగతంగ నామని మమ్ములు తెలుసుకో మన రక్షక మరగతంగ మనసులు
Yeah.
So, should we take a short break now? Stretch your limbs and come back for some more. We will be here.